What's the most you ever lost on a coin toss?
Sir?
The most you ever lost on a coin toss.
This scene from No Country for Old Men is remarkable. It's so tense. A force of deep darkness confronts a simple family man and turns an everyday interaction into one of existential dread. It's sharply written, sensitively delivered, and beautifully shot. It is utterly brilliant visual storytelling. But it also uses a conceit which works so well on film, the simple drama of the flip of a coin. It's pure storytelling. Person, plot, and perspective distilled into a single action. In this video, I want to explore the power of the coin toss in visual storytelling.
Look, I need to know what I stand to win.
Everything.
How's that?
You stand to win everything, call it.
It goes without saying, but visual storytelling needs to show things on the screen. And coins fit the bill perfectly. They provide the opportunity for action, for framing, for composition, and for a reveal. While coins have a financial utility, in storytelling they can have a multitude of meanings. They can represent wealth, desire, vulnerability, and in the case of the coin toss, providence, chance, fate, or decision making. But they don't just stand in for something else. They don't just have an abstract value. They actually matter. In a story, a coin is never just a coin, but it matters that it's a coin. Now, there are genuine fears about loss of freedom as we accelerate towards a cashless society. If everything is just zeros and ones, and finance is controlled by electronic devices and a Wi-Fi code, then, well, money can be lost at the flick of a switch. Digital currency is just abstract value, financial utility. It doesn't have shape, weight, texture, or anything else.
They had magic cards.
When it comes to visual storytelling, going cashless is deathly. The binary code is intangible. We need things we can see. Numbers on a screen don't help us feel the story. With cash, a kid can find a coin in a drain and buy himself a chocolate bar. A coin is an object. And in filmmaking, objects often drive the plot. They draw characters in. They demand attention. Objects invite questions.
What's in the case?
My boss's dirty laundry.
And objects cause conflict. As we see the character react, we learn whether this object is important to them. Objects help us know what a character is thinking, what their priorities are, and what they're willing to risk to keep them.
I've been through too much over this case this morning to just hand it over to your dumb ass.
The importance of objects can be subverted, of course, and people can try to undermine their value and importance in the story, but they still have to be used. They still have to be thrown away. And in some of the greatest stories, it's often something very small that changes the world. You can build franchises with objects. Rings, lightsabers, even gemstones with infinite power.
So this orb has a real shiny blue suitcase, Ark of the Covenant, Maltese Falcon sort of vibe. What is it?
I am Groot.
So what? What's the orb?
$6. It's like a dollar an hour.
So, back to coins. As objects, they occupy physical space. They have physical properties, but they also have history.
You know what date is on this coin?
No.
1958. It's been traveling 22 years to get here. And now it's here. and it's either heads or tails.
This coin becomes the dominant character in the scene. Not only will the flip of it determine the future of the other two, as Anton says, it's been traveling to get here. It's as though the coin pulled these two together.
Don't put it in your pocket, sir. Don't put it in your pocket. It's your lucky quarter.
Where do you want me to put it?
Anywhere, not in your pocket. Or it'll get mixed in with the others and become just a coin. Which it is.
Remarkably, the coin has its own story. And that's the thing about coins in stories. They're powerful. They can determine the narrative. Lucky quarters or lucky pennies seem to have their own mythic ability.
Magic.
Whether they're found on the pavement or in a wishing well, they are powerful. In so many stories, the presence of a coin is a marker for luck or providence, and in visual storytelling, the coin is a visible means of showing the invisible hand controlling the flow of history.
What are you looking at? Fountain of love.
So a coin is an object. It might be an extremely important object, but in a coin toss, it's not just an object. It's so much more. It's actually storytelling at the sharpest point. When a coin is tossed, it will decide the course of the story.
Did you just decide all this with that quarter?
What quarter?
And in this situation, the coin is being used not as coins were intended, it's a secondary purpose. In a coin toss, it's an object, but it's a moving object. The coin has to be flipped.
Heads?
Tails.
Again, this is too expensive. Let's book him.
Now, what's the charge?
Gambling, what else? Come on, chum.
And this reveals that every movie is an action movie. Cinematography means writing with movement or action. In a film, a story is communicated through movement. It's literally why we call them movies. Sometimes a coin toss helps a character make a decision.
That would be your way of deciding it. This isn't a game, it's serious.
I'm serious. How about a toss? That's the quickest.
That's fine with me.
Then let me toss.
It's about drama, tension. While that coin is in the air, everything is possible. And if the coin is covered by a hand when it lands, the mystery remains. As the audience, we either need to see the coin for ourselves, or a character must reveal the result of the coin toss.
It's heads. Jeb, you're the one.
It was a fair toss. So be it.
In this sense, the coin toss itself is pure visual storytelling. The inescapable drama of the unresolved tension. Heads or tails. There are only two options. When an individual's wisdom has run dry, the character will often turn to a coin toss as a last resort.
In a scenario like this, I don't suppose it is bad form to just flip a coin. Heads or tails?
No, I'll do the...
Since the coin itself has no agency, no personal intention, the coin toss suggests that the world is ruled by chance or fate. But is it?
Heads. Heads.
While the flip of the coin itself might be considered arbitrary, the decision to flip the coin at all certainly isn't. Far from being nihilistic, tossing a coin is a religious act. The commitment of oneself to the outcome is a religious commitment.
Coin flip is sacred!
But the question is, what religion is this? Because it's certainly not Christianity.
The world is cruel, and the only morality in a cruel world is chance. Unbiased, unprejudiced, fair.
In the Christian story, in the Christian view of the world, there are limits of human wisdom and reason. And Christian theology acknowledges the sovereignty of God. Lots are cast fairly regularly in the Old Testament, and Proverbs 16:33 goes so far as to say that the lot is cast into the lap, but its every decision is from the Lord. But because God is knowable, personal, Christianity refuses to sink into fatalism. It refuses to say, just flip a coin and you will know the will of God. Tossing a coin ignores the work of Christ in the gospel, the Christian story. It's through this work that the Christian enters a new relationship with God. A coin toss ignores the work of the Holy Spirit in the life of the believer. Christians discern God's will through prayer and petition, through the reading of Scripture and the fellowship of the church. There is no command or encouragement in the New Testament to flip coins to make important decisions. Even the drawing of lots to choose a disciple to replace Judas happens before the coming of the Holy Spirit at Pentecost. From a Christian perspective, it would appear the age of flipping coins is over. But in film and television, the flipping of a coin isn't going anywhere. It's either the final act of the desperate or the forced will of the destructive. So often, those choosing to toss a coin in these stories have appointed themselves executioner. What need is there to put this man's life on the line at all? The coin flip in this sense, rather than being the last resort after all others are found wanting, is a destructive will to power and a refusal to take responsibility for one's own actions. Anton is so menacing because he takes human life so casually. But there's another aspect to his darkness in that he has bound himself to the creed of the coin. He is evil. Lawful evil, maybe, but still evil. I find it interesting that casting lots was one of the very last things Jesus would have seen before he died. They divided my clothes among them and cast lots for my garment. Men cast lots on the ground, refusing to look up at the God nailed to the cross above them. Hello, thanks for watching this video. I really hope you enjoyed it. If you are new to this channel, you are very welcome. Please note that we try to give a theology of storytelling so that you can know that it's never just a story. Please remember that media consumption is optional. You are under no obligation to watch these films or television programs. I'm Reformed Mythologist Nate Morgan Locke. I'm glad you were here.